In this video, we are going to discuss about target language. So target language is the last output of your compiler. Compiler is going to take a source code as an input and it is going to generate a machine level code or an assembly level code. So that is called as a target no code. Okay, so only when the programmer who is designing the compiler knows about this target language, they can design, generate this code efficiently. Okay, so we should know about the target language before generating a compiler, before designing a compiler. Now just here in this video, we're going to discuss about a simple target machine model. Okay, so I'm just going to consider assembly level language since it is hard for us to design a machine level language. So you're going to take an assembly level language as a target language and you're going to generate a target language out of this intermediate representation. Okay, so before starting all those things, we'll just see the different ways in which an assembly level language can be represented. There are n ways in which assembly level language can be represented, and I'm going to take one type of consideration. So here all the instructions that we consider are of three address code. Okay, so you should know what is three address code, right? Like a three address statement is one where in a single line of statement, at most three addresses are referenced. Okay, so you can have x is equal to y plus z. So x, y, z are the memory location where a variable is called. Okay, so at the most an instruction, a statement can have a three addresses. Okay, so that is called three address instruction. Okay, and here another consideration that we are going to take is like we have n number of registers. Okay, so we know that whenever a value need to be computed while execution, these values need to be stored in a register for processing. So we are going to have a consideration that the target machine that we are taking has an n register. So n varies from R0 to Rn. So n number of registers starts from R0 to Rn minus 1 registers. Okay, so this is the second consideration that we are going to take, and we'll see some different types of instruction that is there in this target language, this assembly level language. So we'll just focus on load, store, some operations like addition, subtraction, multiplication and all. So computational operation and some jump statement. There are two types of jump statement. One is unconditional jump. Another one is conditional jump. Okay, so we are going to discuss about these instructions that are like, this is the assumption made in that. Okay, our machine assembly level language, the target language we are going to take has these kind of instruction. So load instruction is used to load a value into a register. Okay, so this load might be of the form LD, the destination along with the address, the source address, from where to where it is copied. So one example is LD of R1 to X. So it means that from the value X, like in the address of X, whatever value resides, that is going to be moved to this R1. Okay, this is one type of load instruction. And another type of load instruction is R1 comma R2. So the value in the R2 is moved to R1. Okay, so load instruction is used to load a value into memory. In short form, you're going to load an instruction, load a value into the register. Okay, so this is a kind of load instruction. So what is store then? Store is used to store the value that is already there in the register to a memory location. Okay, and the syntax used here is st. You'll have your destination address and a register value. Okay, for example, you can have st x comma r1. The value that is there in this register r1 is moved to this x value. Okay, so that is the meaning of a store register and store instruction. And next one is computational operation. So computational operation varies from add, multiplication, subtraction and all. So here comes the three address statements. Okay, so you'll have an operand. Okay, operator. Operator might be either addition, subtraction or multiplication. Along with that, you'll have the destination address and source 1, source 2. Okay, so something like that, like you'll have add R1, R2. So it means we are going to add R1 plus R2 and the result is stored in R1. Okay, so this is how a computational operation will look like. And similarly, when you have a subtraction, subtraction operations looks like R1, R2. So here R1 minus R2, the result is stored in R1. Okay, in both the cases, remember that the value that is previously there in the R1 will be overwritten. Okay, the value will be erased and the new content will be added to the register R1. Okay, in case if you are using this R1 again in the forthcoming thing, then you have to store the value somewhere and we have to do the processing. Okay, so this is the computational operation, and next comes your unconditional jump. So unconditional jump is one where we are going to jump. We are going to have a branch statement without any restriction. So you can have a statement like BRL. Okay, so BR actually denotes it is the branch, and L denotes the label, the address in which the next instruction goes. Okay, so you'll have a label and the first instruction in the label, you'll have an address something like 100. Okay, so this address will be moved over here. So BR denotes branch. It is an unconditional jump statement. And next one is conditional jump. You know what is conditional jump, right? You'll have a condition. Based on the condition, if the condition is true, you have some set of statement to be executed. If the condition is false, you have some other set of conditions to be executed. Okay, so that is called conditional jump, and there are n number of conditions. One example I can give it as BLTZ R, L. Okay, so this actually denotes branch less than R. So it means that the value in the register, if it is less than 0, then we are moving to this label L, or else the next statement that comes after this branch statement will get executed. So that is the meaning of a conditional jump. Okay, so this is the structure of your assembly level language that we are going to consider. So these are all the instructions that actually is there in the assembly level language. So we need to convert our intermediate representation into these kind of instruction type. Okay, and one more thing that you're going to see over here is the types of addressing modes. Okay, so how a variable can be called, how a variable can be stored and all. Okay, so we are going to, the next step is like we are going to discuss about the addressing modes. So these are the different types of addressing mode that we are going to use in this assembly level language. So first one is the basic one, that is a variable name. When we call a variable name, the memory address that is stored in the location, right, that is called. Like when you call x, so the value that is actually stored in the x will be called directly. Okay, so that is the very basic. Like when you have x is equal to y plus z, we can load the value of x directly into the register by calling the value x. Okay, so this is a very basic addressing mode. And next one is the indexed addressing mode. A very important one, like when you are using an array structure, A of R. Okay, so A of R denotes, this R actually denotes the index value in the array A. Okay, so usually we'll have a value of A of I or A of 1, right? So that I value will be transferred to a register and that location is calculated. Okay, so here, like when you have an instruction as load R1, A of R2. Okay, the actual meaning is, for this value R1, this indexed position is stored. Okay, so here how it is calculated now. First, we have to check what is the content that is there in this R2. And along with that, we are going to add the base address. This A actually stores the base address. The like, you know, in an array, what happened? Like the array name will store the first memory location. Okay, so that is moved to A. And R2 denotes the index position, the position in which the element is stored. Okay, so the base address of the array along with the index address will give the actual address of your array. Okay, so the content in the R2 is taken and that is added with this base address. Okay, so this will denote the location of the element. Okay, so you can write it like this. A plus content of R2. So content of R2 will have the index value along with A will have the base address. So this actually denotes the location. Okay, so whatever the content that is there in the location, that will be moved to R1. So that is the actual meaning of it. You got it right? So R2 denotes the index position and A denotes the base address. So A plus R2 will denote the location in which the actual element is there, and that content of that address is moved to R1. So that is the meaning of your indexed address. So this is one thing. And next one is memory location. So sometimes you will have a place like, instead of denoting it as A, the initial position, the address directly will be given. Okay, like something like this. LD R1 comma 100 of R2. Okay, so this 100 of R2 denotes, instead of A, 100 is used. Okay, so 100 is the base address along with R2 is the index position. And this value, the value that is there in this is moved to R1. Okay, so the same instruction can be taken. Instead of A, you can write it as 100. So that is called a memory location. Instead of indexing, we give the memory location directly. And the next one is indirect addressing mode. So indirect addressing mode denotes your pointer structure. So whenever you have pointer, you know what is pointer, right? So pointer denotes address of element. So whenever you are using pointers, we call that addressing mode as an indirect addressing mode. And here the memory location is calculated as something like this. LD R1 comma star 100 comma R2. Okay, so in the same instruction, when you have star, that actually denotes it is a pointer. Okay, so this entire thing, it denotes an address. Okay, so the actual representation can be given as, you know, for calculating this, you can write it as 100 plus content of R2. So this will have the value that is there in this place. Okay, so the value that is there in this, and the entire content is denoted using this star. Okay, so you can write it as content. Okay, so content of 100 plus content into R denotes this entire location, the element that is there in this 100th position. Okay, so and this entire thing, it is an address. That is the meaning. Like when you have star, it means that the value in the location of this element. So you are going to add one more content. So one more content actually denotes this is the address. Okay, so this entire value will be transferred to this R1. So that is the meaning of an indirect addressing mode. Okay, and the last one is immediate addressing mode. Immediate addressing mode is one like where when you want to call a value directly, like when you want to store 100 directly into a register, you can use your immediate addressing mode. So you can write it as LD R1 comma hash 100. Okay, so this hash operation denotes it is a value that is directly going to pass instead of an, it is a constant value. Okay, it is not a variable. We are not going to denote any memory location over here. It is a direct value, constant value. We are going to pass it to the working of it. And similarly, when you want to add some value to R1, you can write it as this 100, hash 100. So with the register R1, this 100 value is added and that is stored back into the register R1. Okay, so these are all the basics. So here, this is how a target language can be represented. Okay, this is one consideration that is taken for our representation. So we saw what is an assembly level language and what all the different types of instruction that can be done in this assembly level language. Along with that, what are the different addressing mode that is there in this target language. Now, we'll take some example and we'll just convert that intermediate representation to this assembly level code. So that is how a code generator works, right? It is going to take an intermediate representation and it will convert that into a assembly level code. Okay, so we'll take some examples. In all representation, I'll give one example in that. So first instruction that we take over here is x is equal to y minus z. Okay, so you have to subtract the value of y from z, and y and z actually denotes it is a variable name. Okay, so that comes under your first addressing mode. So first we have to transfer, like whatever operation that we perform over here, the value should be there in the register. So that is a consideration we need to take. So first we have to convert, like send this value of y to a register. We can use a load instruction, load r1 comma y. It means the value in the y will be moved to r1. And similarly, load the value of z into r2. And this is in subtraction instruction. So you can write sub r1 comma r1 minus r2. So y minus z is done over here and the result is stored in r1 register. And the result need to be stored back to this x. So you can write it as st x comma r1. Okay, so this is our assembly level language, assembly level representation should be there for a instruction. This is a very basic instruction. And next we'll consider one more instruction, like I'll go ahead with the next type of addressing mode. We'll write the instruction for an array representation when you have b is equal to a of I. Okay, so when you have an instruction like b is equal to a of I, so here a denotes the base address, I denotes the index position. Okay, so first this index position need to be stored into, loaded into an array. So you'll have a load instruction ld r1 comma I. And the next step is very important. Like this I actually denotes it is the index position. And for each and every data type, you have a different type of representation. The memory address, the memory used for each and every data type vary. Like for integer, it is 4 byte. For a floating point, it is 8 bytes. So it varies according to the data type. So what we have to do now, we have to calculate the actual position of I. Okay, so for calculating that, we should know what is the data type of it. And for this example, I'll just consider this I is a floating point data type. So I can take, this array A of I is a floating point type. So to store one little value, we need 8 bytes of memory location. Okay, so for I number of elements, we have to calculate it by multiplying with 8. Okay, so next you have a multiplication instruction, MUL, this I value that is stored in R1. R1 will be multiplied with 8. Okay, so you can directly give 8 with hash 8. This R1 is multiplied and the result is stored in R1. So now this R1 will actually give the exact position of this I. And then you are going to load the instruction, load this into a register. The actual content that is there in this R1 is loaded to R2 and it is stored back to B. Okay, the value that is there in R2 is stored back to B. This is how an array instruction can get executed. Okay, just don't forget about this calculation. Okay, how you are going to increment your index value. That is very important. Okay, so this is one type. And next type is, like, we'll take one more example. So here, the array value is stored into a constant. What happened in the reverse of it? When you have a of j equal to c. Okay, so here the value that is there in c is moved to an array. Okay, so for this kind of instruction, so first c might be there in a register. So we load this content that we want to store into a register. Okay, so now next we need to calculate this address. Okay, jth position. So for calculating the jth position, what we have to do? First, move this j value to a register. I'll consider this as R2. The j value is moved to R2. And we are going to calculate the actual position. So the same instruction can be represented over here. So I'll just take, this is also a floating point type. So this R2 is multiplied with 8. So that the exact position of that address is calculated. And we just store the result that is there. This C value is stored into A of R2. Okay, so in A of R2, the result, the C value will be stored back. Okay, so this is all about the basic representation. Now we'll take one more example with the pointer type. What happens if you want to do the same process with the pointer type? So I'll just take one example. X is equal to star P. So star P actually denotes
the value in the address P need to be stored. Okay, so here the instruction, the assembly level code for this intermediate representation is, first we should know what is there in P. So we load the value of P into a register R1, and then we need to calculate the actual value that is there in that address. What is the value? Okay, so here this P already has the address. So we don't have any instruction directly to call it. So we can call the instruction as load R2 comma 0 of R1. So 0 of R1 means the value that is there in this address P. So there is no index value. So the 0 denotes the base address is 0. So whatever is the exact address that is denoted by this P, the value will be moved to this R2. So that is the meaning of it. So now R2 will have the value of P. Now that is stored back to X. So we can have an instruction X that stores R2 value into X. Okay, so this is how a pointer value was copied. Okay, pointer value is used. The same case, what happened in the reverse of it? When you have star P equal to Y. Okay, another example, when you have star P equal to Y. So in this case also, we are going to do the same. First, we should move the value of P into a register R1. Okay, and similarly, Y value also need to be moved to a register R2. Now what we have to do, we have to copy the value that is there in R2. Y value need to be stored back. Okay, this value need to be stored back to the address of P. Okay, so address of P is denoted. So value of P is denoted by 0 of R1. Okay, so this is your next type of instruction. And finally, for demonstrating the conditional jump, we'll take one example. So that example is, like, we'll consider if X less than Y, go to L. We'll consider this statement. So here, the assembly level code for this statement can be given as, first we should know what is X, Y, and we need to calculate whether X less than or equal to Y, less than Y. Okay, so to calculate that, first we have to load the value of X into a register, Y into a register. So we'll just move X value to R1, load Y value to R2. So now we need to find whether X is less than Y. So for calculating whether it is less than Y, we need to make a subtraction of it. So we're going to subtract R1 and R2. So it was X minus Y, and the result is stored in R1. Okay, the reason is, like, this register is not used again. So we just store the result into the same register. Like, instead of wasting so much of register, calling so much of register, it is better to reuse the registers that are already used. Okay, so now the subtracted result is there in R1. We are going to check whether if the value is less than. So if the value is less than, it means that it should be less than. The subtracted value should be less than 0. Okay, so we are going to have a branch statement. Branch less than. Okay, less than 0. You are going to make a jump. Okay, so it actually means branch less than 0. When the value of R1 is less than 0, it means that X is less than Y. Then we are making a move to jump to this M. So M is the label that is denoted by L. Okay, so M actually denotes the starting address of the label L. So we are going to make a jump. Okay, so this is how the assembly level code is generated out of an intermediate representation. Okay, so this is one small example, a simple model for this target machine language. Okay, a simple target machine model. This is how it works. And again, so whatever the target language you generate, there are n ways in which we can generate a target machine. The efficient one is calculated using its cost. Okay, and the cost factor of each and every instruction is based on the number of memory location it is verified. Okay, so when you have the registers alone to be occupied, like here the subtraction operation, you have 3 registers to be copied. So here the cost of the instruction is usually 1, Okay, the reason is when you are just using a register that is there, the values that is there in the register, the cost is made as just for the instruction alone. But when you have a location reference like y or 0 of, a of R1, so here a memory location is verified. So in that case, the number of variable, the number of memory location that is verified will be added to the cost. So cost of these instruction will be 2. Okay, there is no exact way in which the cost is calculated. So this is generally how a cost is calculated. So based on the cost factor for different target programming programs, so we'll just choose the efficient one out of it. Okay, so this is all about the target language. Thank you.